Alright, so a very good evening to all of you. Now in today's lecture, I'll be talking about unified theory of clusters. Before I begin, many of you do complain that I don't post regular videos, and today will be the reason you will see why, okay? Because I have done about 2 weeks of dedicated research on cluster chemistry, and it's not a topic of my specialization or I'm not working on it. So I should take out time separately to do research on this particular topic so that I can come up with a unified theory to find the geometry as well as the cluster type of any kind of metal cluster, okay? Because you know, for transition metals, we have a different theory like polyhedral skeletal electron pair theory or Wade's rule. Then we have this 4N rule for Zintl ions. So we have a lot of rules, and there are a lot MNO rule, right? Jemmy's rule. There are so many rules, Bingo's rule. So there are tons and tons of rules for clusters, and you know, you tend to get a lot confused. In fact, in my last video which I made on Bingo's rule, many of you still had a lot of confusion, as you can see from the comment section also of that video. In case you haven't seen that video and you want to see that video, you can click the link over here, okay? And then I made a video on metal-metal bonds, how to find the number of metal-metal bonds. That was quite easy and that was quite simple, and you could have easily done it. For that also, I'll provide the link somewhere over here. Now this lecture could go about till about 1 hour also. I won't be surprised if this lecture goes on for 1 hour also, because there's so much content that I have to discuss with you. But with apart from this video, once you are done with this video, all your doubts will be cleared, I can assure you, okay? And you would, and this is unified theory. You just need to know one rule, and with that one rule you'll be able to do everything, okay? So I've taken a lot of examples. In fact, I don't like to teach it with a paper, but I've just written on the examples which I am going to teach, so that you have a better approach to solving those questions, okay? And then there were two questions. One was from your December 2016 exam. Both were from December 2016 exam, for which nobody has able to give you any explanation, nobody at all. One is ReH92-, how to find the structure of ReH92-, okay? And then the other was, I think the other question was from December 2016, that how to find the geometry of RH6CCO15-, okay? And you have been given structures like heptagonal bipyramidal, tricap, trigonal prism, monocap cube. So you know, it sounds like something from a different world to many students, right? So today everything, all your doubts are definitely going to be cleared, okay? Now let me see just if it's okay. It's working fine. So let's begin, okay? First of all, let's begin with the easy examples. I will discuss all these examples, right? Before that, if you don't know about how to find number of metal-metal bonds and how with the number of metal-metal bonds also you can find the geometry of the molecule, if you're not aware of that, I've given you the links for both the videos. You can watch that to find the number of metal-metal bonds, okay? Or how to find the geometry using the metal-metal bonds. I'll give you one simple example, okay? Simply, if we have, what do you have to do? You have to calculate the total valence electrons and then subtract minus 18 into number of metals. N is the number of metals upon 2. Like for example, if I take the example of OS3CO12, okay? So osmium contributes how many eight electrons, okay? Osmium contributes 8 electrons. If we talk about the d orbital, osmium contributes 8 electrons, right? Yes. So 8 electrons from osmium, so that means there are 3 osmium, so 24 electrons. And the contribution of CO, this all is there in 18 electron rule. So I hope you are aware of the basics, okay? CO contributes 2 electrons. So CO contributes 2 electrons. So 8 plus 24 plus 24 makes it 48. Okay, this makes it 48. Now what you have to do, this is the total valence electrons. 48 is the total valence electrons. Now what you need to do is, you need to basically divide it by you have to do the opposite, 18 into 3. So 18 into 3 will be 18 into n. N is number of metals. Number of metals is 3. So all number of vertices, okay? Not number of metals, number of vertices, or number of metals also in this case. It's both the same thing. Basically, how many vertices are there? So there are 3 vertices. So 18 into 3 minus 48, and you just divide by 2. You just divide it by 2. So 54 minus 48, that means 6. 6 upon 2, 3. So basically, number of metal-metal bonds in this case is 3, okay? Number of metal-metal bonds in this case is 3. Then if I talk about a similar case, OS3CO13, instead of 12 I have done 13. So for 12 we had total number of valence electrons as 48, so for 13 we have one more CO, so the total valence electrons will be 50, okay? The total valence electrons will be 50. And then what we do the same thing, 54, 18 into 3, 54 minus 50 upon 2, so this gives us 2. So the number of metal-metal bonds in this complex is 2, and the number of metal-metal bonds in this complex is 3. So what does it tell you about the geometry? In this case, OS3CO13, the geometry will be linear. Why? Because there are 3 metals and there are only 2 bonds, so it has to be linear. So this will be the geometry, okay? This will be the geometry for OH3CO13, which has 50 valence electrons, okay? And what will be the geometry for the other case? For the other case, we have, I'll stand this side only, it's better. So for the for this, it's 48 electrons. So we have, we have three metal-metal bonds. So in this case, the geometry will be triangular. There are three vertices. So this is how you can find the geometry using the number of metal-metal bonds also, okay? That which, in which case it's triangular, in which case it's linear. So let's say this complex is there. Many of you might think that there are three vertices, so it might be a triangle, OH3CO13. But in fact, if you find out the structure, it comes out to be linear, and that is the reason. Because if you find the number of metal-metal bonds, it comes out to be two. And the only way to arrange this is in a linear geometry. Whereas it has three metal-metal bonds, so you can see 1, 2, 3. So this is triangular geometry, okay? Now coming on to the real deal, that how to unify these all these theories. How do we actually unify all these theories? Okay, so to unify all these theories, you have to know isolobal analogy. That's it. I'll keep this paper, later on we'll see how to solve it. So isolobal analogy, okay. Now how do we use this isolobal analogy? So isolobal analogy, again a very basic topic, yet I'll tell you. So if we have let's say clusters which are, you can say, like for example, if you have a BH cluster, okay, if you have any cluster, let's say osmium CO3, this is the transition metal cluster. So if you have to compare this transition metal cluster to the main group cluster, what do you have to do is simply, this is 8 electrons, osmium contributes 8 electrons, 3 COs contribute 6 electrons. So the total comes out to be 14. Okay, the total comes out to be 14. Now all you have to do is subtract 10 from it. Whatever value you get from the cluster, subtract 10 from it. So if you subtract 10 from this, it becomes 4. Okay, if you subtract 10 from it, it becomes 4. Okay, it becomes 4. And now what you have to do with this 4? You basically have to equate it to a main group element. So always try and equate it to boron. Okay, why you should equate it to boron, I will tell you later. Okay, I'll come to that, but always equate it to boron. So 14 minus 10, whatever electrons are there in the cluster, you subtract 10 from it, you'll get 4. So 4 can correspond to BH fragment, or it can correspond to carbon fragment also, okay? Because BH means boron contributes 3 valence electrons, hydrogen contributes 1, so it becomes 4. Carbon also has 4 valence electrons. So 4 basically comes out to be either BH fragment or carbon fragment. In case we have 15 electron complex, like nickel cyclopentadiene, where nickel contributes 10 electrons and cyclopentadiene contributes 5 electrons. So in that case, it is a 15 electron complex. So subtract 10 from it, it becomes 5. So it can be BH2. It can be CH fragment, or it can also be N fragment, because nitrogen has 5 valence electrons. So you can replace that particular transition metal fragment with a main group element like nitrogen, CH, BH2. But I am telling you, always replace it with BH2. Okay, why that? Because we can correlate it to our basic geometries. I think this is very basic, yet I will just go on to that basic as well. For example, if we have, I have written down over here, so I'll teach you from this side only, that BnHn+2, okay, BnHn+2 is chloro, okay, BnHn+4 is nido, BnHn+6 is arachno, BnHn+8 is hypo, BnHn+10 is clado, okay. This is very, very basic, you know, you can say boron rule, that for borons, if we have a structure like BnHn+2, or you can also write it down as BnHn2-, okay, you can write it down as this. So this is basically chloro structure, this is chloro. Then if we have BnHn4-, then this is nido, okay. Then we have BnHn6-, it's arachno, okay. If in case we have BnHn only, there is no, both borons and hydrogens are equal and there's no charge, then this is called this is also chloro only, HN+2. You can write it this way also. This is called super chloro. Okay, not super chloro, sorry, hyper chloro. This is called hyper chloro. This one is called hyper chloro. And then if we have BnHn+2, a +2 charge, then we can say it is super hyper closure. Okay, so these are the nomenclatures, different nomenclatures. What role they have, we'll discuss later, and what role does do these geometries have, we'll talk later, because many of you had doubt over here that I had written 6 is equal to trigonal pyramidal. So you said that I've written the geometry wrong in my Mingo's rule video. So it's not wrong. I'm talking about skeletal electron pairs, not the coordination number or the number of vertices. Both are different. Okay, so please don't get confused over here. That confusion also I will try and clear today. Okay, so these are the basic geometries for borons. So how do we have to use these basic geometries for borons to find out the structures? So now let's come on to the real deal. Okay, what is the time? So I will give this in the initial video that you can start watching from 10 minutes if you want to skip the basics. So let's take an example. We have bismuth 5 3 plus. Okay, bismuth 5 3 plus. And see, in that rule which I told you, where you have, if you had 15 electrons, you subtract 5 and then you can write it in terms of BH fragment, like you can write this as BH2. That was applicable for if you have to compare transition metal compounds to the main group elements. But if you already have a main group element, like bismuth is already a main group element, then we can directly write it in terms of BH fragment, because bismuth comes in the nitrogen family. We have bismuth 5 3 plus, right? So bismuth comes in the nitrogen family, and nitrogen family has 5 valence electrons. So 5 valence electrons you can replace by BH2. So over here, bismuth 5 3 plus, instead of going through this whole rule that you had been taught, 4N rule, right? You don't have to go through that 4N rule. You just have to compare everything to borons. That's it. That's the whole thing. That's how you unify everything. Just compare everything to boron. Okay, so we have BH2. Okay, so you can replace this bismuth 5 by BH2. So if you replace one of the bismuths by BH2, we get BH2 whole 5 3 positive charge, right? So if you take this 5 inside, we are getting B5H10, and then we have 3 positive charge. Okay, so I hope it's clear, right? 3 electrons from boron, 2 electrons from hydrogen, right? So we have B5H10 3 plus. Now it's 3 positive. Now you have to check whether, you know, you have to get it in form of BnHn. Like for compounds I told you, for closure it is BnHn2- or BnHn+2. It's better to take it in the form of BnHn. Like BnHn2- is closure, BnHn4- is nido, BnHn6- is arachno, right? Like B6H6, 6- is arachno, B6H6, 4- is nido, B6H6, 2- is closure, like that, right? Now hydrogen. Now we have B5H10, so we can write it in terms of B5H5. Okay, we can write it in terms of B5H5. So now what will happen to 5 hydrogens? You have to imagine those 5 hydrogens acting as ligands. Okay, you have to imagine those 5 hydrogens are acting as ligands. Okay, those 5 hydrogens are acting as ligands. So what you do, you take those 5 hydrogens. Okay, you take those 5 hydrogens and you remove those ligands. If you remove 5 hydrogens which were contributing -1 charge, so if you remove all those 5 hydrogens which were contributing -1 charge, so you on the complex you will have -5 charge as well. Okay, listen to me very carefully. If you're removing all the 5 hydrogens, so those hydrogens were giving -1 charge. Okay, as a ligand, hydrogen gives -1 charge. So that so if you are removing those 5 hydrogens, thus that -5 charge will be left on the complex. 5 hydrogens are removed, but -5 charge will be there on the complex. So 3 plus and then -5 charge. So overall charge becomes -2. So we get B5H5. 2-. This is nothing but closure. So you don't have to go through this rule. You just have to convert this bismuth 5 3 plus into the appropriate boron. Okay, there might be some confusion over here, but that's why I've taken a lot of examples, so that every confusion of yours is cleared. Now what about the structure? We'll talk about the structure also, don't worry about that. Okay, so one is bismuth 5 3 plus. Now let's take another example. Let's take SN9 4 minus. Okay, so SN belongs to carbon family. Carbon family has 4 valence electrons. So 4 valence electrons means you can replace it with BH fragment. You can replace it with BH fragment. So let's replace it with BH fragment. So we have BH whole 9 and 4-. So you can make it as B9H9 4-. Simple. B9H9 4-, you can automatically tell me the structure is nido. We'll come on to structures also, how to find structures, we'll come on to that later. First let me just tell you the basic funda. So B9H9 4- nido, finished. Okay, let's take one more example. One more example, SB4 2 minus. SB, antimony, SB4 2 minus. So SB also belongs to nitrogen family. So nitrogen family has 5 valence electrons, so BH2 fragment. So let's replace BH2 whole 4 2 minus. So B4 H8 2 minus. So what do? We have to make it B and HN. So we make it B4, 4 hydrogens are extra. So we make it B4 H4, and those 4 hydrogens extra will have 4 negative charge. So we'll add 4 negative charge to this complex, it will become 6 minus. So this is arachno. So cluster type is arachno. So no need to memorize this 4N rule, simply replace it with the BH fragment, the appropriate BH fragment, and compare it to the original borons like BNHN2 minus, BNHN4 minus. From there you can know which what kind of cluster type is it. So no need to go for another rule for specifically for zinc-alliance. Okay, and I hope it is filming, because I'm going to make it a long video. So it's about 15 minutes now, 16 minutes all obviously. So anyway, now coming on to how to find from the skeletal electron pairs the geometry. Okay, before that, let me take you an example of a transition metal. Okay, let me take an example of a transition metal. Like for example, this will also clear a lot of doubts. OS5CO16. So generally for such clusters, you have been taught polyhedral skeletal electron pair theory, that you calculate the total valence electrons. From there, you subtract your, the 12 into number of vertices, and then you divide it by 2 to get the skeletal electron pairs. Okay, like that you have been taught to find the geometry. Okay, whether it's close only to arachno. So that a lot of confusion over there. Here you simply have to substitute it with a boron fragment. So now this is a transition metal. Okay, so what you can do is always try to get this number of vertices, like there are 5 transition metal atoms, so try and get equivalent amount of ligands. Why should that be? I will tell you. So you can write it down as, you can write this complex down as OS5CO15 into one more CO. You can write it down as like this way. Okay, OS5CO15 and one CO. Okay, right now it might be difficult because I am trying to unify everything. But once I unify everything, this is the most simplest theory you can find to predict any kind of geometry, any kind of cluster type for any kind of metal, be it main group, transition metal, mixture, whatever it is. So OS5CO15CO. Okay, so now I have basically got this in the multiple. Okay, these are multiples 5 and 15. So now what I do is I take 5 common, and over there what I had done was, like I was removing hydrogen, so I was giving minus 1 charge because hydrogen was contributing minus 1 electrons. As a ligand, hydrogen contributes minus 1 electrons. So when I was removing hydrogen, I was giving minus 1 charge. Now over here, I am removing CO. Okay, I want to remove this CO. This CO is extra, I don't want that. So if I am removing CO, CO contributes 2 electrons. So I will have minus 2 charge on the complex. Okay, so I will have minus 2 charge on the complex. So OS5CO15, and one of the COs I have written as charge of minus 2. Now I take 5 common. So if I take 5 common, this becomes OSCO3. If I take 5 common, this becomes OSCO3. Okay, this becomes OSCO3. So this is 8 electrons and CO contributes 2, so 6. There are 3 CO, so 6. So 14 electron complex. So this is a 14 electron complex. So I can replace it with the isolobal analogy by a 4 electron complex. So what is a 4 electron complex? BH. BH is a 4 electron complex. So I can replace this OSCO3 fragment by BH complex. Okay, so let me do that. So if I do that, so this becomes 5 into BH. Okay, so and obviously we have 2 negative charge, 2 negative. So this becomes B5H5. And then we have 2 minus. You can tell me the cluster type. Simple, it's closo. Okay, I'll just recheck, it's closo. There you go. Okay, let's take one more example. Let's take RH6CO16. You might be thinking I'm taking easy examples. Don't worry, I'm just building a confidence on this principle. And then I'll come on to the complicated ones, and especially those two ones from December 2016 for which nobody has been able to give you a correct explanation. Okay, I'll come on to those ones as well. So RH6CO16. Okay. So again, we will do the same thing. We have 6 we have 16 COs, so either we can make it 18 or we can make it 12, anything that you want. Okay, I prefer making it 18, so I will take 2 COs extra. So if I'm taking 2 COs extra, I'm taking extra COs. Okay, I'm taking extra COs. Well, I'll not confuse you guys. Let's take out 4 COs. Okay, let's take out 4 COs. So we have got RH6. You'll be able to figure it out later when you do it on your own. So now we have taken 4 COs out. So these 4 COs are out, and I can replace them with -8 charge. So I can give the complex -8 charge. Okay, I can give the complex -8 charge. So now we have 6 common and we have RHCO2. So RHCO2, RH contributes 9 electrons and CO contributes 2 electrons, so 2 COs will contribute 4. So 9 plus 4, 13 electron. 13 electron complex is what? Boron. Boron is a 13 electron complex. Okay, so boron is a 13 electron complex, so I can substitute this RHCO2 by boron, and we have 6. So we have 6 borons, so I can write it down as B6, and then we have 8 negative charge. So we have B6, 8 negative charge. Now I have to add the hydrogens as well, because boron does not exist as it is. So we have 8 negative charge, so we can add 8 hydrogens if we want, but we want it in the form of BN HN. So we'll only add 6 hydrogens so that 2 negative charges left out. So this becomes B6H6, and then we have 2 negative charge. Tell me, what is it? It's closo in nature. And if you want to find the number of skeletal electrons, let's say in the question they have told you to find the skeletal electrons, then it is easiest to find the number of skeletal electrons with the help of boron, okay, not with the help of transition metal. It is much easier to find the total number of skeletal electrons with the help of boron, because boron simply contributes when you have to first get the complex. Okay, whenever you are trying to calculate the skeletal electrons, this is also a question that was asked in I think June or December 2017 exam. Okay, that whenever you have borons, always get it in the form of BnHn. Always try and get it in the form of BnHn. Okay, and then whatever charge is there on the complex, it could be plus charge or minus charge. If it's minus charge, those electrons will be added to the skeletal electron pairs. If it's plus charge, those electrons will be subtracted from the skeletal electron pairs. Okay, I'll take an example. So we have B6H6 2 positive and B6H6 2 minus. These are the two complexes, B6H6 2 minus and B6H6 2 positive. So let's try and find out the number of skeletal electron pairs. Okay, sometimes what happens, this is the question given to us and they are asking number of the cluster type and the number of skeletal electron pairs. So let's say you found the cluster type to be closo, but you don't know the number of skeletal electron pairs. There's a very simple method also, but sometimes you get confused, so I will tell you both the methods. So if you have to calculate the skeletal electron pairs, multiply number of borons, first get it in the form of BnHn, that is number of borons and number of hydrogen should be equal, get it in that form, then multiply the number of borons by 2. Each boron contributes 2 skeletal electrons. Okay, each boron contributes 2 skeletal electrons, so 12 plus hydrogen contributes, you don't have to take contribution of hydrogen, boron contributes 2 and 2 negative charge, so plus 2, so this becomes 14 skeletal electrons. So this complex basically donates 14 skeletal electrons, and if you have to calculate the skeletal electron pairs, then you just divide it by 2. That will give you the number of skeletal electron pairs. So for this complex, the number of skeletal electron pairs is 7. Let's talk about this B6H6 2 positive. So again, same thing, 12, you multiply the number of borons by 12, 2, and then you have 2 positive charge. So instead of adding 2 electrons, you have to subtract 2 electrons. So this becomes 12 minus 2, this is equal to 10. So this complex has 10 skeletal electrons, or it contributes 10 skeletal electrons. And if you have to find the skeletal electron pairs, then you just divide it by 2, and this comes out to be equal to 5. So it has 5 skeletal electron pairs. Okay, now it's very simple also to calculate the skeletal electron pairs. You know B6H6 2 minus, what is it? It's closo in structure. So for closo, you might have heard that skeletal electron pairs ACP is equal to, for closo structures, is equal to N plus 1. This is true for closo. Okay, this is true for closo. Skeletal electron pairs is equal to N plus 1, where N is the number of vertices. Then for nido, it is N plus 2. For nido, it is N plus 2. Okay, N plus 2. For arachno, it's N plus 3. Okay, for clado, it will be N plus 4. And if you go a little, if you go for hyperclosure, it is N. And for super hyperclosure, it's n minus 1, where n is the number of vertices. So you see this B6H6, 2 minus was nido. So you already know that it has 6 vertices. There are 6 borons, so there are 6 vertices. So n plus 1, you already know this structure belongs to closure. So you can just do n plus 1 and you will find the skeletal electron pairs to be equal to 7. And we have verified it experimentally also. Not experimentally, we have verified it with the help of calculations also. Similarly, if we have B6H6 2 positive, you know B6H6 2 positive is what? B6H6 2 positive, what structure is it? It is super hyperclosure. Okay, and if you need to verify, you can see for super hyperclosure, number skeletal electron pairs is 6 minus 1. 6 is the number of vertices over here, so 6 minus 1, so that will be equal to 5, and that is what we are got. So either you can use this rule, n minus 1 for super hyperclosure, n skeletal electron pairs is equal to n for hyperclosure, it's n plus 1 for closure, n plus 2 for nido. Either you can do that, or you can just simply use this rule to find the skeletal electron pairs. Okay, great. So now let us take the help of this table. This is very important. This you have to memorize. There's no other shortcut to it. If the skeletal electron pairs, please remember it this way. That's why in the earlier video also I had taught you this way. Okay, let me check how long has been the video. It's already 25 minutes. So I'm going to tell you once again. Please memorize it with the help of skeletal electron pairs, not with the help of the number of vertices. Why? I will tell you later why that is important. Okay, it's very important and I will tell you why. So skeletal electron pairs, if there are 6 skeletal electron pairs, the basic geometry of the polyhedron. Okay, what is a polyhedron? Basically a cluster of different metals. Okay, for one metal you can easily predict the geometry. Okay, for example, if we talk about WME6 has a trigonal prismatic geometry. It does not have octahedral geometry. Why it is so, I will tell you later. Okay, it does not have octahedral geometry, it has trigonal prismatic geometry. Okay, so this is for simple metals. For simple metals still it is very easy to predict. But what happens if we cluster many metals together? Okay, if we cluster many metals together, then it becomes difficult to predict the geometry of the cluster. If we cluster a lot of many, like 6-7 metals together or 12 metals together, how many number of metals? Okay, and why is cluster chemistry important? Why do we pay so much attention to cluster chemistry? Is because we don't know when single metals or how many metals have to basically combine together so that they start showing a property of bulk metals. So to find out that when these small metals, when they are clubbed together, at what point do they start acting as bulk metals? So to bridge the gap between, you can say, a small metal atom and bulk metals, the cluster chemistry comes in somewhere in between. Okay, so that's why it's important for us to study cluster chemistry. So skeletal electron pairs, if there are 6, the structure is trigonal pyramidal. Okay, skeletal electron pairs. Trigonal pyramid or bipyramidal, whatever you like to call. Okay, I have written over here pyramid, you can call it trigonal bipyramidal. Okay, or trigonal pyramid, sometimes they like to call it trigonal pyramid or trigonal bipyramidal. Okay, that is a basic geometry. If skeletal electron pair is 7, then it is octahedral or octahedron also. So in some books it's written as octahedral, in some books it's written as octahedron. Or there's another geometry that can also be there, that is trigonal prism. Okay, but the basic geometry is octahedral. The basic geometry you have to remember is octahedral. Trigonal prism is also another geometry which might be there. Why it will, when will it come? That also I'll talk about. Okay, then for skeletal electron pairs 8, we have pentagonal bipyramidal. Now skeletal electron pairs 9 is where the confusion comes, because over here we have lot of basic geometries. Like we have dodecahedron, we have hexagonal bipyramidal, we have cubic structure, we have square antiprism. Okay, please note it down. Okay, dodecahedron, square antiprism, cubic structure, hexagonal bipyramidal, bicap trigonal prism. Okay, there are many structures for skeletal electron pairs 9. Now how to differentiate over here, don't worry, we'll talk about. For 10, again there's only one basic geometry for 10, that is tricap trigonal prism. Okay, for skeletal electron pairs, please remember for skeletal electron pairs. Then for 11, we have bicapped square antiprism. What is this bicapped, monocapped? That also I am going to talk about. For skeletal electron pairs 12, we have octadecadihedron. Okay, octadecadihedron. And for 13, we have icosahedron. Okay. Now, when we have 6 skeletal electron pairs, when will these ideal geometries exist? That is also important. So when are these ideal geometries going to exist? We are saying that ideal geometry for skeletal electron pair 6 is diagonal bipyramidal, for 7 it is octahedron, for 8 it is pentagonal pyramidal, for 11 it is bicap square antiprism. But the question is, when are they going to exist? When are we going to have these ideal geometries? Now we are going to have these ideal geometries when the number of vertices, the number of vertices n over here is 1 less than the skeletal electron pairs. That means if we have 6 skeletal electron pairs and we have 5 number of vertices, then basically it means that we will have the basic geometry. Or in other words, this is one way to look at it, that 1 minus the skeletal electron pairs. If we have number of vertices is 1 minus the skeletal electron pairs, then we'll have these ideal geometries. Okay, but you can also remember it the other way. What is closo? Closo has skeletal electron pairs as n plus 1, where n is the number of vertices. So basically, for compounds which have a closo structure or a closo cluster, okay, for compounds which are existing in closo clusters, for them they will all follow ideal geometries. For closo clusters, because for closo clusters we know skeletal electron pairs is n plus 1, and that is exactly what we want for ideal geometries, n plus 1, n plus 1, n plus 1. So for all closo clusters we will follow ideal geometry. For all closo clusters we will follow ideal geometry. Okay, this is the basic case. There are a lot of exceptions, and I've taken those exceptions also into the account. Okay, how can we know about the exceptions? But this is basic, that skeletal electron pairs is equal to n plus 1. So for all closure structures, we have basic geometry. Okay, so basically if we have a compound which has 7 skeletal electron pairs, we calculate the skeletal electron pairs. First we take any, if let's say there's a transition metal compound, so we convert that transition metal compound into boron type, boron hydrogen type, and we find out whether it's closo, nido, arachno. Okay, let's suppose it comes out to be closo. So let's take this example only, B6H6 2 minus. So it has 6 number of vertices, and you know the structure type is closo, so it has to be an octahedral structure. It has to be octahedral, B6H6 2 minus. If you want to calculate skeletal electrons, 6 into 2 12, plus 2 electrons 14, and you divide it by 2, so skeletal electron pairs comes out to be 7. So there are 7 skeletal electron pairs and the number of vertices are 6. So this basically follows our octahedral geometry. But there is a but. Okay, what if we have P5H5, or let's say we have B7H7, only B7H7, no charge, B7H7 no charge at all. So if you try and calculate, you multiply this by 2, so you get 14 electrons. Okay, if you try to calculate the skeletal electron pairs, boron, 7 boron, 7 into 2 upon 2, so skeletal electron pairs comes out to be 7. As it is, you know this is a hyperclosal structure, because number of vertices is equal to skeletal electron pairs. This is the basic geometry for hyperclosal structures. Okay, now for hyperclosal structures, you already know that skeletal electron pairs is equal to number of vertices. We have also verified it, that skeletal number of vertices is equal to skeletal electron pairs. That means that skeletal electron pairs is 7. Now this is the most important part, okay, and I'll highlight this as well. 33 minutes. Okay, this is the most important part. 7 skeletal electron pairs, that means the basic geometry will not change, it will be octahedral. The basic geometry is going to be octahedral. 7 skeletal electron pairs means that the basic geometry is going to be octahedral in nature. Okay, but we don't have number of vertices as for B7H7. For B7H7, the number of vertices that we have is how much? For ideal geometry we should have 6 vertices, but we have 7 vertices. We have 7 vertices. So we have 7 vertices, but the basic structure is octahedral. So skeletal electron pairs is 7, so that gives us the basic geometry. That's why I was saying the skeletal electron pairs is more important for you to understand, because that will give you the basic geometry. So just one second, so the basic geometry is octahedral, but we don't have 6 vertices. For octahedral, all of you know, we should have 6 vertices, right? For octahedral geometry, if we have this metal complex, right, so this is octahedral, so we need 6 vertices. But over here, what do we have? over here we have 7 vertices. So how do we accommodate the 7 vertices in the octahedral structure? So what we do is something called as capping. With that one extra metal, we have 7 vertices, 6 we have accommodated, there's one more boron. Okay, if this is the case, there's one more metal or one more boron, whatever is the case. So what do we say? We have capped that metal. So we cannot accommodate it in the basic octahedral geometry, but what do we call? We cap it. Okay, we kind of cap it. That is this vertice, this extra you can say vertice is shared between two other vertices. It's like a cap structure. You put a cap around it. Okay, that's why it's called capped. So if you put one cap, it is called monocapped. If you put two caps, if there are, instead of 7, let's say we have 7 skeletal electron pairs, but we have 8 number of vertices. So we have basic structure as octahedral, but now we have 8 vertices. So 6 can be accommodated, but there are 2 extra. So then we'll have to add one more metal. Then it will become bicapped. If we have 3 more, it will become tricapped. If you have 4 more, it will become tetracapped. Okay, so like that the nomenclature goes: bicapped, monocapped, or simply monocapped can simply be called as capped. That means only one extra vertice. If it's bicapped, there are 2 extra vertices. If it's tricapped, 3 extra vertices, like that. Okay, and what if we have one less vertice? So let's take an example of B5H5 4 minus. So you know B5H5 4 minus means nado structure. For nado, you know no skeletal electron pairs is n+2 for nado. You can verify it also. 5 × 2 = 10 plus 14/2. So skeletal electron pairs will come out to be 7, or it can be n+2. Number of vertices is 5. So skeletal electron pairs is equal to 7. So for 7 skeletal electron pairs, structure is octahedral. Basic geometry, basic structure is octahedral. But now what do you have? You have 5 vertices. So for octahedral you need 6 vertices, but you have only 5. So what you'll have to do from the octahedral structure only? These 4 are in the plane and these 2 metals are axial. So the axial bond is of less energy compared to these bonds, these 4 bonds, right? So what you'll do, you'll remove one of the vertices. So what geometry you get? Square pyramidal. So for this B5H5 4 minus, basic geometry is octahedral, but its structure will be square pyramidal. So that's why over here you will not get trigonal pyramidal, because for trigonal pyramidal you need 6 skeletal electron pairs and 5 number of coordinates. Over here the number of coordinates or number of vertices is 5, but the skeletal electrons are 7. So the basic geometry has to be octahedral, and from octahedral you have to remove one vertice. In capped you will have to add one vertice. Over here you are removing one vertice. So because you are removing one vertice, that's why this will become square pyramidal. So the geometry for this will be square pyramidal. Okay, now let's do one question from CSIR exam that will give us more clarity. Okay, and when will it be trigonal prism, that also I'll discuss. So that question was that PB9 4 minus, this was the question if I'm not wrong. PB9 4 minus. So for PB9 4 minus, this was a question for 4 marks in the exam. Now, thankfully with the help of options only, you just needed to predict the cluster type. You did not need to predict the geometry. If you had correctly predicted the cluster type for this, you would have got 4 marks. But let's say you are not that lucky with options, and you need to find the structure of this compound or the geometry of this compound as well. Then how will you do? So PB9 4 minus. Okay. So, PB belongs to which one? PB belongs to your nitrogen family. Sorry, it's carbon family, right? Sorry. Yeah, it belongs to carbon family. So, so it belongs to carbon family, and we have carbon family means 4 valence electrons. So we can replace it with a BH fragment, right? And 4 negative. So this becomes B9H9. 4 minus. So basically the cluster type you know is nido. If the cluster type is nido, you need skeletal electron pairs is n+2. Number of vertices is 9. So this becomes skeletal electron pairs becomes 11. So the basic geometry is bicapped square antiprism for 11. The basic geometry is bicapped square antiprism. This is the basic geometry. But for that, number of vertices has to be 10. or it should have been a closure structure, but we know it's an IIT-JEE structure. And you can see the number of vertices are 9, not 10. So number of vertices are 9, and the basic structure is bicapped square antiprism. So bicapped square antiprism, that means the original structure was square antiprism, right? The original structure was square antiprism. Then I had one more extra vertice, so I made monocapped. Then I had one more extra vertice, I made it bicapped square antiprism. So this is the basic geometry for 11 skeletal electron pairs. Now you might be debating that why bicapped square antiprism is the basic geometry, because this is the most stable geometry. That's why for 11 skeletal electron pairs, the basic geometry is bicapped square antiprism. But for that, the number of vertices need to be 10 for this structure to be valid. But the number of vertices are 9. That means from bicapped square antiprism, we'll have to remove one vertice. Bicapped square antiprism is the ideal structure when we have 10 vertices. Like for octahedral, we needed 6 vertices. But if we have 5, we'll have to remove one vertice. So from bicapped square antiprism, we'll have to remove one vertice. So which vertice will you remove from bicapped square antiprism? Let's take an example. Let's take an analogy of octahedral also. So if you have octahedral structure, okay, if you have octahedral structure, and okay, let's say you have monocapped octahedral. Let's say you have a monocapped octahedral where this is the cap structure. Now if you want to remove one vertice so that this geometry is of the lowest energy, what will you remove? You will not remove something from the octahedral structure. You will remove that cap structure. Similarly, so you'll remove this cap structure if you have one less vertice. If the basic geometry is monocapped octahedral and you'll have to remove one vertice, you'll remove the capped vertice. Similarly, when we have bicapped square antiprism and the number of vertices is 9, that means you have to remove one vertice. So that vertice will be the capped vertice. So from bicapped square antiprism, it will become monocapped square antiprism or capped square antiprism. So the answer was for PB94-, the basic cluster type was NIDO and the structure was capped or monocapped, whatever you like to call it, capped square antiprism. This was the basic structure. Same case. Let's say the structure was arachno. Let's take one more example. Let's take this example only. PB9 6 minus. So if you calculate, this becomes B9H9 6 minus. That means arachno structure. So if it is arachno structure, I would have to take some other example. Let's take it PB8. Okay. I wanted to explain you something. PB8. Okay. Let's take it PB8. So this becomes B8H8 6 minus. So this becomes B8H8 6 minus. So this becomes arachno structure. For arachno, we know N plus 3. So number of skeletal electron pairs is 11 because number of vertices are 8. So 11 and number of vertices are 8. That means 2 less. So for originally bicapped square antiprism, which had 11 skeletal electron pairs, we needed 10 number of vertices, but we only have 8 vertices. That means we have to remove 2. So from bicapped square antiprism, if we remove 2, so we'll remove both the capped vertices. So if you remove both these capped vertices, what are we left with? Square antiprism. So many of you will get confused if the options are dodecahedron, hexagonal, bipyramidal, cubic, okay, and square antiprism. If these are the 4 options that are given to you, that dodecahedron, hexagonal, bipyramidal, cubic and square antiprism. So many of you will get confused if you remember with the help of coordination number, because you will see the coordination number is coming out to be 8. So that means the number of vertices are coming out to be 8. So if the number of vertices are 8, that means it has to be any one of those structures. But only those of you who will be clear with skeletal electron pairs will be able to get the right answer, that it is square antiprism, because you are removing from bicapped square antiprism, you are